This is the last session of the day. It was a pretty hot topic during the competitor subcommittee meeting, and hopefully I can provide you some general guidelines and information. As far as my background, obviously ballooning is my passion, but my professional background is that of a certified public accountant. I worked for an international firm for about 14 years until I went into the restaurant business. And I must admit, I learned a lot more in the restaurant business than I did studying accounting in college. But at any rate, we're going to talk about financial and budget considerations for the next half hour or so. This is the organization chart, slightly modified from what Sam had put up earlier. I draw your attention to this side of the chart. This is basically the organizer side, and this is the director side, or the championship, the competition side. Notice what I've put here. This is, and I mentioned this during the competitor subcommittee meeting, or EDS also, to run a successful event, especially one of a Cat 1 category that may have a budget of several hundred thousand dollars, you must have a financial manager as part of your team. The relative expertise of this person can certainly vary, but you better have somebody that knows and understands budgets and how to keep you above water, as we say. So that's a really critical part of any organization team, and I encourage you, if you intend to bid on, submit an intention to bid, there's lots of assistance in your local community to get someone that has this professional expertise. Get them on your committee. If you don't have that expertise, go find the person that has it and get them as a volunteer. I wouldn't recommend you want to be paying for this position, but there's help out there, and I strongly encourage you to make them part of the organizer's team. Here's some important questions that we've got to try and figure out. First of all, we have to evaluate the financial structure of the event. Are we going to have government or visitor and tourism support? Can we get a title sponsor? Is there in-kind support available? In-kind support means you may not get dollars, but you may get a product that is critical to the execution of your event. A prime example would be propane. In the U.S., many of our major competitions have the benefit of a propane sponsor. I think our nationals propane sponsor guarantees at least covering 15,000 gallons, and that's for about a 50 balloon event, something of that sort. So that's what I mean by in-kind. Maybe you can get in-kind from hotel or hospitality. There's lots of creative ways to seek in-kind support. A type of in-kind support that doesn't help you pay any bills is your local media. They love to consider themselves a major sponsor of your event, and they'll give you radio spots, they'll give you newspaper spots, they'll give you television spots. That's great, but it won't help you pay any bills. So you got to keep in mind, if a media comes to you and say, we want to give you 50,000 euros in support, that's great, but it won't help you pay one bill towards your organizational structure, unless perhaps it allows you to go out and seek a major sponsor that can then be promoted through the media contribution that you've got. So in-kind sponsorships are very, very important. And lastly, we have to determine what's an acceptable level of pilot support via entry fees. What's an appropriate percent that the pilots should be covering? What's the nature of the expenses that the pilots should be covering? It's probably very appropriate if pilots are covering perhaps the cost of the propane or the officials that are necessary to run the event. And there's a lot of costs associated with necessary officials at a Cat 1 event. And we'll cover some of that later. But this is part of the determination when you evaluate the financial structure that you're going to have. Next, you have to prepare an initial budget. In the intention to bid, which is presented really a year before you have to present your sanction application at the CIA plenary, you've got about a year to put a really quality plan together. And an initial budget is part of that plan. Are you going to know everything about your budget 2 years in advance or 3 years in advance? Of course not. But going through the exercise of an initial budget plan is really part of the management process. And it's critical that you go through the exercise. Number one, it demonstrates you know what you're getting into. You know what cost you're committing to. You know what it's going to cost you either to use the venue, to organize and sponsor opening ceremonies, closing ceremonies, pilot parties, so on and so forth. You have to go through that exercise. And while that budget may change three or four times over the 2 or 3 year period, that initial budget is critical, and it really needs to be part of the initial sanction application process. And we'll talk more about some of those details later. Question in here, how many in here understand the difference in fixed and variable cost? Show of hands. Wow, that's excellent. I would have never expected that. We're going to talk about why you need to differentiate and understand the difference between those two costs. And we'll look at some of the costs of a Cat 1 event and try and determine, are they fixed, are they variable, or what's called semi-variable, which means there's a fixed element, but there's also a variable element to that cost. We'll talk about what are Cat 1 fixed costs, what's included with the pilot entry fee. Pilots and the application process deserve to know and understand that. Dealing with hotels and food service providers, negotiate, negotiate, negotiate. When it comes down to signing contracts and you've got a signed contract, the negotiation period is over. But in the year or two leading up to a Cat 1 event, you generally are in the catbird seat. People want to sell you their products, and you can negotiate much better terms on the front end if you know and understand. Hotel and hospitality people are used to negotiation. You got to be aware of that. Also, if there's questions at any time, please holler. We're going to talk about here, this is a gold rush individual back in the gold rush days in the United States out in California, and I call it panning for gold. When you're trying to raise revenue, that's exactly what you're doing, and you better get creative in terms of how can we fund a major event like this. Here's a list of potential revenue sources that I just want to breeze through quickly. Pilot entry fees. What do we need and what is fair and equitable? You've got to determine that as an organizer. Sponsors. Sponsors are absolutely key in order to minimize or make equitable pilot entry fees. A title sponsor should easily sell for a Cat 1 event in the neighborhood of $10,000 to $50,000. I know major events in the U.S. are able to get this kind of sponsorship at the local level, whether it be corporate, whether it be Convention and Visitors Bureau, whether it be government. There are title sponsorships that you can sell. Corporate tents. How many events in here sell corporate tents? Any show of hands? They sell for big bucks. I know this guy over here sells his for big bucks. But even in my local event, I've got a 50-balloon event. that is not a national event by any means, corporate tents sell for $5,000 to $10,000 a piece. What's a corporate tent? Corporations in your local community can use this tent sponsorship to bring their invited guests. It can be an employee party. It can be their VIP guests. But in order to do this, you need a common venue that is guaranteed a show for these people. Yes?
One question, what do you include in those tents? Is that catering included or what?
No, on the $5,000 to $10,000 in our event, you get a tent and you get tables and chairs. You want catering, you want entertainment for the kids, all that is extra. And believe me, corporations, hospitals, insurance companies are more than willing to invest in that type of sponsorship. So they're out there and they're available. But again, to make it work, you need a CLA. You need a show place. I look at Saga and I see the crowds that cheer the balloons coming in to that target area. That's a perfect venue to sell those sponsorships. And you don't have to fly into that common area every day, but maybe your weekend is your showtime. That's your payoff period. So you can use those sponsorships that way. We already talked about in-kind. Oftentimes you can go after propane, hotel discounts, food and beverage, advertising, infrastructure needs. A unique way to help get your hotels to help you fund, if you can go to a hotel and say, you know, we're going to be bringing in and we will probably book, if you've got a 100 competitor event, you're probably easily going to book 150 and probably close to 200 rooms. That's a lot of rooms. And you approach the hotel in this fashion. We will promote you as our lead hotels. Give us your best rate on that. But in exchange for us promoting you as our prime hotel, we want you to give us X number of free rooms. You've got to cover jury. You've got to cover senior staff. And they will do that in the exchange for selling at normal rates. It's not like you're not asking them to sell at a higher rate to the pilot, so you're not transferring the burden onto the pilot. But if you bring in a hotel as the major hotel that you're promoting for the event, lean on them and get free rooms. Conventions get that all the time. And for a 200 rooms at an average stay of what for a Cat 1 event? 10 days? What is that? 2,000 room nights. That's big, big dollars to the hospitality industry. So keep that in mind. Be creative. State and local tourism grants. Usually, and I think this came up during competitors or whatever, this is what we bring to the table. We bring a show. We bring something to make your community feel good. Maybe the event is free to the community. It doesn't have to have a gate. It could be free to the community. But if it is free to the community, you better have other avenues of support, whether it be corporate sponsorship, tents, convention and visitors bureau type dollars, city, state, government. I asked David Gleed at lunch today on his proposal for the North Americans and his bid on the Worlds, and I said, he talked about getting government money. I said, well, what level is it at? Is it state, local, federal? All three. So there's lots of dollars out there. There's grant money that you can go after. But again, you can't start that process the year before your event starts. But in the budgeting process, if you genuinely start that 2 to 3 years out, you can work that into your plan. If you're going to go after state or other government entity funds, they want to see your track record. Now, if you're a first-time event, well, odds are you're not bidding on a Cat 1 event if you've never run an event before. So whatever event you run locally, I'm sure you've got press clippings. You've got a source of that you can demonstrate to a sponsor or to the government, we will bring in X number of people. That X number of people will spend Y amount of dollars, and you can then demonstrate an economic impact for your local community, and you will have to do that if you're going after government money. They want to see a return on their investment. Same with visitor and tourism bureaus, that kind of thing. So save your clippings. Make sure you have a good portfolio to show potential sponsors what you can bring to the table for promoting the community or the sponsor, so on and so forth. Get an experienced grant writer to be a volunteer on your committee and go mining for those dollars, because those dollars are out there. I know in the U.S., I can't speak for other areas, but I got to believe every part of the world wants to develop tourism, and they have money to promote that, so go find it. A gate. A gate may or may not work in your community, and maybe rather than an admittance gate, you charge for parking fees. You can raise tens of thousands of dollars just charge for parking. 5 euros for a carload, 10 euros for a carload. So you're not disappointing customers that come and then it gets weathered out because you haven't sold a gate admission. All you did was charge them for parking. And so they shouldn't be knocking down your door for refunds as long as you're pricing it for the cost of parking. Concessions, again, this ties into if you have a CLA, a show position where pilots will be flying into or flying out of as part of your championship competition, typically on a weekend, now you can sell to concessionaires. Because if you can draw the crowd and you have concessionaires, those typically on a weekend will sell for the equivalent of 150 or 200 euros. And if you've got an event, and I think of the crowds at Saga, and imagine the amount of money that a crowd like that would spend on concessions, it's huge. And concessionaires are willing to pay you good fees to do that. How many in here have been to Albuquerque Fiesta? Can you imagine the dollars that are spent on the vendor row in Albuquerque? It's huge. Now, granted, that's a pretty unique number of visitors that they're getting there. But when people come out to an event, they're ready to spend money, especially if they're bringing kids. Kids will ensure that they spend money. We all know that. Arts and craft shows, that kind of thing, you may or may not want to get into all that as an organizer. You better be big enough and have enough in your organization chart if you're going to spin off these kinds of things. They're great add-ons for revenue, but you daresn't lose focus on what the primary purpose of your event is. And if that's a Cat 1 championship, again, you can't lose focus on that. But if you have a good event director who is going to work with you and can assure you the technical side of the championship is going to be handled, then you and your committee can concentrate on the infrastructure, raising the money and promoting your event. How about a little audience participation here, if you're willing to share this information? We're not trying to dig out your proprietary information, but can anybody give me any creative methods that perhaps you've used to raise money if you're talking about a local event or a Cat 1 event? If we can get a mic to go around the room there. And again, this is where an event like this pays dividends. I've always said my best ideas I have stolen from somebody else. And that's what this is about, sharing of ideas. Find ways to get creative. Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you, Mary. First of all, thank you for the last half an hour. That was the best half an hour for me during this event at the moment. So what I will say, give you some remarks about sponsorships. I'm working more than 20 years about in this kind of job, and at the end you have to focus it or to look out, is it a sponsor B2B or B2C? That's the first idea what you have. For example, when I see ExxonMobil for the Albuquerque Fiesta, it's a typical B2B company. Means the idea of ExxonMobil is to invite his customers to have a happening or something else than the normal fear or house fear or whatever. So that's the first idea. But if you make it public, you need definitely sponsors for a B2C, yeah, Coca-Cola or whatever, for example. Yeah, but that is what you have to in your mind, and it's important for your organization what you want. Yeah, for example, when I'm looking back to the Honda Grand Prix in Luxembourg, especially, it was a typical B2B sponsor because they invite his customers in the VIP tent. So, and they make in the surrounding something for the public. So it's always a mixture of everything. So that's it means if we have a B2B company, give them the opportunity or give the ideas because they work always, they have partners. For us as Plaza, for example, we have industrial partners all over the globe. And my idea is to make an event in all areas in the world with our partners, and Plaza as main sponsor or whatever, but with our partners, because our partners have the same customers as us, and therefore we have the chance to collect more money for your event at the end.
Yeah, you're in that case you're promoting an event, a happening, an experience. And it may not be to a retail type customer, vis-a-vis Coca-Cola. Coke is appealing to the masses, and that's where they want to see that Coke logo in print. They want to see it on mass media. Your customer doesn't sell to the masses, but you can sure entertain the critical people in your company.
But that's what I say. You have to think about it. What do you want in this event? A mix or only this or only the others? Yeah, that's a point. But I see the chance for all of us in the B2B companies more than in the public companies, because they spend a lot of money, millions of dollars every year in our partnerships. And this is, and the networking between of them, that makes money at the end.
Agreed, yeah. And that's where the corporate tense is a similar type of situation to what you're talking about, but maybe more on a local level as opposed to national or international level. Anybody else have any different approaches perhaps you've taken to raise money for even a local event, or what, that maybe we haven't talked about thus far? Okay. We can move on. Let's talk a little bit about what's happened to pilot entry fees over the last few years. I just went back to 2012 for Battle Creek. Could have gone back further, but I think it does show what's happening in the world of pilot entry fees. In 2012, Battle Creek, their entry fee was about 1,100 euros, but it also included hotel for the entire duration of the event. It included pilot parties in addition to the opening and closing ceremonies, and it also covered the cost of observers. So it was an event that had observers as well as electronics. So there were a lot of extra costs involved in that application, and when you consider going to an event for 1,100 euros, that was not only your entry fee but your hotel cost for the week, I think you'd consider that a pretty good bargain. In 2014, Brazil's entry fee was 300. These are all in euros. 300. Japan 400, Austria 400, 20 was postponed. Slovenia had bid at 600 and requested and received an increase to 900. And we talked in the competitors subcommittee today as to the reasons for that. I mean, their event was postponed. They had to go back to their sponsors. There could well be good reason for that jump to 900. This year, we've got two bids on the table. Spain's bid is 1,850 and Hungary's bid is 990. So costs are definitely increasing, especially in this spiraling inflationary time that we find ourselves in, driven by COVID, driven by supply chain issues. So I'm not showing this to be critical of what the bids on the table are asking this year, but we are asking a lot of pilots. And the question, the comment that I made in competitors subcommittee was, are the world championships becoming a championship of elitist or wealthy individuals are the only ones that can afford to come and compete? I hope we don't wind up with that. We want the best competitors in the world, not necessarily the best that have the deepest pockets. And that's something that I would ask events that are bidding through the budgetary process. Just think that through. If you can find more creative ways to fund this so that we can have the best competitors in the world there, regardless of what they can afford to attend the event. I think that's important. So I think this is an important thing to consider as part of your budgetary process. All right, major expenses. Here, for those of you who may not know the differentiation between variable and fixed cost, you can see the blue block on the bottom. Those are fixed costs, and by definition, those costs don't change regardless of whether you have 50 competitors or 100 competitors or 150 competitors. You've got certain costs that are absolutely fixed. And it's absolutely fixed whether the weather is great and you fly 7 days in a row, or the weather is crummy and you only get two flights in. The fixed costs are fixed, and they're going to be there regardless of what happens throughout your event. Variable cost increases depending on volume of the event. That's the differentiation of the two. And how you budget depends in large part on whether the cost is a fixed cost or a variable cost. So you just need to have some general awareness of that. So let's talk about what are major budget expenses on a Cat 1 event. Under administration and overhead, you've got to come to the plenary. You've got to, if you're in a competitive bid situation, you're probably going to want personnel here to help sell your bid, right? That costs money. You got to get them here. You got to present the bid. The sanction fee and the bond. While the bond is refundable if you meet all the requirements of the contract, the organizer's contract, but the sanction fee is not. That is not refundable. I think sanction fee currently stands at 5,000 Swiss francs for all events. I could be wrong on that. I'm not sure about Gordon Bennett, but I believe Cat 1, as far as the balloon events, are at 5,000 francs.
I think it depends on the number of competitors. If I recall correctly, just 50 euro per competitor.
Oh, it is. So it is variable based on the number of competitors. Okay. But typically with 100 or 100 plus 5 or whatever, so you're at that 5,000 level, but it would be variable in that regard. Housing, pilots and crew. The organizer, again, I mentioned this earlier, you can negotiate a better deal to help you cover the cost, the required cost of your jury and senior officials. Work that angle for sure. Officials, you're going to have travel stipends. You've got rooms. Meeting rooms, is the hotel, if you've got a major host hotel, all your meeting rooms should be included. And that's where it should often benefit you if you're working a deal with a large hotel that has banquet rooms, meeting rooms, and that kind of thing, because if you're booking a lot of room nights, you should not be paying any room rentals. It just shouldn't happen. And if you're opening ceremonies is in there, you're buying a lot of food and beverage as part of that, or maybe your closing ceremony. To have a opening and closing ceremony for a Cat 1 event, you better have it better be a pretty big hotel in order to do that. Oftentimes, you have to rent civic centers and event centers in your city, and that will have a cost associated with it. Under hospitality, are you going to provide refreshments for your pilots, coffee, pastries, fruit in the morning or whatever, opening and closing ceremonies? That is required by your bid contract. Propane refueling manifolds, what's the average number of gallons per flight? If you're running a major competition, you could easily burn, on average, 30 gallons a flight, maybe 35, depending on the task string. So you've got to really think it through, how many gallons of propane that you're going to need. And the cost of propane, we all know, is skyrocketing. From what I understand, a lot more in Europe than it is in the United States. But nonetheless, it's certainly a major expense. Insurance. We talked about this earlier. You've got to protect, the organizer has to protect itself. You as officials want to make sure that you're protected. If an accident happens, the attorneys will just go up and down trying to find the deepest pockets to sue. And don't think that I'm just a balloon director, I'm just a lonely safety officer. Don't think that you're immune to being named in a lawsuit, certainly not in the United States, and I don't know how it is internationally, but you want to make sure that insurance is something that's considered. Pilot awards and what I call bling, whether it be t-shirts, pins, pilot packs, the typical grab bag of goodies that a pilot may get upon registration, that all has cost. Launch field, the show venue and the infrastructure, do you have the availability of a large complex to use free of charge? Again, if your city's buying in and they have a common grounds, a huge soccer field or a football complex or whatever, and especially if it has stands for the general public to observe, that's a wonderful situation. You may have to pay rent. You may have to pay the city for police, EMS, that kind of thing. If you've got a good community that wants to have a show in their community, they may cover that cost for you, but they may not either, so you have to be aware of that cost. Porta-johns, tents, utilities, you've got to have power, water, that kind of thing. Again, if you're going to have a common venue where you can really raise some money, it also has costs associated with that. Trash, security, signage, fire safety, EMS, all that type of service could potentially have a cost. Entertainment. I indicate this is high risk and reward. If you have the idea, I'm going to have a concert at my event on the weekend, don't necessarily assume you're going to make any money off that deal. The band will make money. The entertainment will make money, because regardless of weather, they're going to get paid. So be careful what you look at for auxiliary entertainment. An air show. Depends on the cost of the air show. You bring an air, I know in Battle Creek, Battle Creek Field of Flight has an air show, and they do quite well with that. But it's about a 7-day event. The fact that the air show is there, they bring in carnival rides. If I'm not mistaken, I was told by that organizer, the carnival rides writes the organizer a check for, I think, about $30,000 just to bring the carnival rides in. That's a lot of money. Again, get creative in how you approach this. But entertainment is high risk, high reward, depending on what it is and what weather brings. Of those costs, what do we consider fixed and what might we consider variable? The sanction fee, it's fixed in that odds are if you're bidding on a Cat 1 event, you got 100 competitors. So you're in the 5,000 Swiss franc category. Travel stipends for officers, senior staff, and jury, that's fixed. Your contract requires you to provide that. Lodging for staff and officials. It's pretty tough to get staff to come in if they're not at least getting their lodging paid for. And travel stipends. Travel stipends, depending on where you're located, they could run from 300 euros to, I don't know, 500 euros or more, depending on the event and what you're capable of providing. Opening and closing ceremonies are very expensive. You tend to want it to be a big show, whether you bring in entertainment as part of it and the banquet itself. Food costs today have escalated to unbelievable amounts. Food costs in the U.S. are probably up 30% over where they were pre-COVID. And then a lot of things are driven by the fact that you can't even get them anymore. So you got to be real careful on that. You've got a lot of equipment rentals with your venues, unless, again, you've got a provider in a city or a convention bureau that's willing to support you. Maps, banners, those kind of supplies, those costs are fixed. Prizes and medals, insurance, the performance bond, but that is refundable, assuming you meet the requirements of the bid. Variable cost, advertising. You don't have to have advertising, but many would argue that if you want to have a crowd and you want to satisfy the demands of your sponsors, you're going to need some advertising. Pilot packs, apparel, pre-briefing refreshments, equipment rentals, printing, propane, copiers, paper, supplies, staff vehicles, gas. Those are all types of variable costs that you're going to experience. The bid process requires you to submit a budget. You need to think about all these, and even if it's 2 years out, 2.5 years out, you need to do the best you can to estimate what these costs are going to be and make it as part of your budget. A concern that is a valid concern on anybody bidding on an event is, I don't want to share my budget. It shouldn't be public because it's proprietary. I'm bidding against two other NACs that want the same world championship. They should not have privy to my budget. And EDS has assured you that that will not be shared. But that budgetary process needs to be part of your application so that EDS can evaluate, have you planned, have you thought about how you're going to run your event? They need that information and, in fact, demand it as part of your application. But on the other hand, you should rest assured that will not be posted for public consumption. That's only common courtesy. How you fund your event, and if you make some money on your event, that's fine, as long as it's a well-run event and you're not making money from the pilot side of things. You can make all the money in the world that you want to if you run a successful event, have a major sponsor, run a venue that can create dollars. That's all well and good. But it's very, very important that the delegates and the organizers that are bidding on an event understand that a preliminary budget as part of your initial application is a requirement. It's not an option. It's a requirement. Any question on that angle? That's pretty important. Sample budget. I don't know if you can read that very well, but there's two elements to the budget. You've got the revenue side, which I have up here. In this particular case, this shows sponsorships that are cash. There are sponsors in kind. My technical expert here is going to try to expand that. Very good. Okay, thank you. Sponsors in kind. I would probably venture a guess that this was the planning budget, and this is feeling good and hoping you can achieve this. That's a phenomenal amount of in-kind sponsorships. God bless you if you can get it. But again, it's part of this particular budget. In this case, I know this particular organizer had propane sponsored and also had a sweet deal with hotels to get the needed room nights for a number of the officials. So those dollars add up in a big, big hurry. Pilot entry fees. You've got a fiesta division, perhaps, to help you with the show side of things. Vendor fees, if you've got concessions, and merchandise sales. In this particular example, hold on. They're showing total anticipated revenue in excess of $530,000. Okay, that doesn't mean it's going to fit any other particular event that way, but it does show you that this is part of the plan. Show us where you think your revenue is going to come from. On the expense side of things, the list is certainly a lot longer than on the revenue side. But you go through all the major categories. If you go into the CIA documents, you will find sample budgets. And it will take you through the thought process of all the kinds of expenses that you've got to cover. So be aware of that. And again, this budget was put together differentiating between cash expenses and in-kind expenses. So take a look at the number of places that they've got in kind. Customs and storage was a big item on this particular one. And when you're dealing with international transportation of balloon equipment, customs and storage is something to consider. And they got a pretty sweet deal with that as opposed to having to pay and opposed to having to pay that, pass that cost on to the competitor. So that was a big deal in this particular case. Okay, I don't know if there were any questions on that. On that display on the revenue and expenses, but here's my conclusion, and then we can open up to the floor for comments or questions or whatever. I think first and foremost, you got to understand that organizing and running a Cat 1 event requires sound financial management. If you don't apply sound financial management, somebody's going to lose a lot of money, either the organizer or the pilot or both. Again, having a financial manager as part of your organizing team will save you a lot of aggravation. Budgets must be fluid. You can't predict 3 years in advance what all your costs and revenue are going to be. You have to re-prepare that budget periodically. Take a fresh look at where you're at after you begin to know what your firm costs are going to be, what you think your sponsorship opportunity might be. So that budget needs to be fluid, needs to be have the ability to be modified so that the management team can then react to that new budget. oh my God, we lost our major sponsor. We got to find a way to cover, fill in the blank, the dollars that we just lost. Know your fixed cost. Know what you're getting into. The financial burden on competitors will begin to make attendance based more on personal financial situation than competitive skills. I think this is something the delegates need to understand. Isn't our objective to have the best pilots in the world at the World Championship? I think you'd all agree with that. Get creative with in-kind support. There's lots of opportunities out there. Negotiate with local hotels and hospitality suppliers. I've been in that business for almost 40 years, and I can assure you there are deals to be made, and don't underestimate that. Can we get some light in here, and then we can maybe do some Q&A? That's the end of my presentation, but happy to talk about anything that was presented here. Anybody have any comments or questions? Nobody? You all got a plan now? Yes, sir.
Yes, only to be one to make questions, okay? No, just only to add one thing. I am 99% with you. I agree. I think it's a great job and so. Just only in the slide number 7, for example, okay, you are speaking all the time with to handle with locals, hotels, okay? How long in advance do you do that? Because it's not the same to do it 3 years in advance than 1 year in advance.
Right.
Because, for example, he and me, we will go, or I have seen now 100 hoteliers. I can handle with them. I grow up with them. But it's really very difficult to get good prices 3 years in advance. It's really very hard.
Oh, I agree. But you can start the negotiation process. You can begin to go to your hotel, your room supplier, and say, what if I'm submitting a bid? I haven't secured the bid yet. So you've got to dangle a carrot for that hotel as well and say, I don't have this bid yet. Do you want to partner with me? If I can bring you 2,000 room nights, that's a pretty sweet deal for you, right? So can you solidify the deal 3 years in advance? No. But maybe you can set the hook 3 years in advance and get them to be
yes, it's the way to go, but my experience, for example, on Mallorca, when they say we will be always full 100% for sure, it's difficult, but it's able. There are ways to go in that direction. It's only a recommendation in case that you want to do this in your countries. Speak not only with hotels, speak with associations of hoteliers or hotel chains, because they are able to give mostly also very good prices, and you can handle with them more than with one hotel.
If you're in prime tourist season, And you're running an event in a tourist area, vis-a-vis Mallorca, you don't want to have it in prime season, because you will never get a hotel deal in prime season. So on the bid process and thinking about when you're going to do it, it's the same with your local community. If you have a major music festival in town and they sell out every room, the restaurants are packed, the first week of June every year, well, if you're going to organize an event, you may not want to do it the first week of June. You may want to find a time that works with your weather, of course, but also works with a time in your community where you can bring some value to your community in an off season, if you will. Does it always work? No, not necessarily. Obviously, Cat 1 events generally seem to be in the August, September, or even later time frame. But generally, just be flexible on that so that you can work the best deal in your community, if that makes sense.
And then just only to add, maybe I miss it, I don't know, but I would like to encourage everybody to organize a European or World Championship. It's really a very amazing thing. If you are in an area where you are also a commercial pilot, and some of us are also commercial pilots, passengers, I don't know if there is there, you can get, if you make your own branding, your own marketing as company, you can get a great value. It's also not to forget the passengers that you can take at that moment and after the years. It's also an income, yes, only a tip, so as suggestion.
Fiesta and the VIP side of things can bring dollars, you're right, yeah, whether it be rides or, I hate to associate sponsorship with rides, that has a problem, but if you've got a Fiesta division that can handle the show for you, then you can't expect the competitors to provide. Competitors aren't going to carry sponsor riders for you. It not only is it not safe, it's just not wise. You don't want to get involved that way. But if you've got other balloonists, the Fiesta division, if you will, that can carry that load, they can make money and they can solve problems for you as well. Anybody else have thoughts or comments? You look very thirsty. I don't want to keep you from the cocktail party, but feel free during cocktails. The benefit of a session like this is the exchange of ideas. That's what's really, really makes a session like this work, and that's what we're trying to encourage here. But the FAI, it's easy to say they're here to help you, and it's an awkward situation, and sometimes you may not get the help that you need. But I think if you ask for the help, it's not working. Honest.
Okay,
this works. If you ask for the help, I guarantee you will get it. And the chain of command, we've got two working groups or subcommittees that support pilots. One is EDS. Andy chairs competitors. That's about supporting the competitors. And this new subcommittee that is putting on this event today, event organizers subcommittee. It's not that we're going to have one of these seminars every year. I don't think that would work, but I think we can bring expertise to the table to help you if all you have to do is ask. Okay? Any other? If that's it, thank you for your attention and enjoy the cocktails.